Hi everyone, it's your boy Zach, and this is my I don't know, reaction video. Do people still say reaction videos? Anyway, I saw this article earlier before taking Luna on a walk. I've just skimmed it, but it looked like it would make a good video. So this is about Eric Stevenson, publisher and chief creative officer at Image Comics. Basically, I don't know, roasting DC for hasty sociopathic decisions. We'll see. You know, obviously, I think the last time I talked about Eric Stevenson in a video was like 3 months ago, right at the beginning of COVID, where he was throwing out, what do you call it? Challenges to the industry to help out stores, to make stuff returnable, to, you know, give them, you know, more favorable terms than they typically get. And that's been about it. Was a letter he sent out to, looks like everyone. So written today, June 11th. Dear creators, he starts with a quote, "Those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. It's true. We can either learn from past mistakes or we can make them again. In comics, it often seems as though we like to make the same mistakes. Just ask DC." So first of all, this is a completely different attitude than a couple months ago. Where he was, it was all rah, rah, you know, and, you know, I challenge Marvel, DC, and everyone else. Now he's very pointedly attacking another company. Now, this is interesting because that's kind of not really a thing. Even as, the funny thing is that creators attacking customers, that's a thing. That's just regular business now. But still to this day, publishers attacking other publishers, that doesn't really happen. Even like DiDio, like he came right up to the edge of saying Marvel is flooding the shelves and that's hurting everyone except for Marvel. But he just kind of vaguely described Marvel while not saying it. And so this is probably the most pointed I've ever seen, you know, any criticism from one publisher to another pretty much since I started, you know, this channel more than three years ago. Back in 1994, Marvel bought a distributor called Heroes World. At the time, there were multiple distributors. Wait a minute. There could be more than one distributor in the comic book industry. I don't believe it. That sounds like science fiction. At the time, there were multiple distributors, Diamond Comic Distributors and Capital City Distribution being the largest among them. So there was even more than three. There was multiples. So Marvel bought Heroes World and then announced they would distribute exclusively through that one outfit. DC's response was to sign an exclusive with Diamond. Most likely because, you know, losing their largest client, Diamond probably had some fairly favorable terms to offer DC to keep them. So DC signs an exclusive with Diamond in 1994-95 timeframe. And then that prompted Archie, Dark Horse, and Image to negotiate with both Diamond and Capital for exclusives. What? Oh, okay, I'll just move on. Diamond made the better offer. Oh, okay, so you were discussing and then you settled with Diamond. Viz and Kitchen Sink signed exclusives with Capital, but by 1996, Capital's business was failing and Diamond bought them out. A year later, Heroes World went out of business too, and Marvel returned to Diamond. Why Diamond? Well, Diamond was the only distributor left by that point. Sure, there were some small distributors handling indie and alternative titles, but they didn't carry anything from the major publishers. For a publisher of Marvel's size, Diamond was literally the only remaining option when Heroes World went out of business in 1997. And lest we forget, Marvel was in bankruptcy at the time. So here we are in 2020, with the world in something approaching the worst shape it's ever been in. Bruh. Oh my gosh. Really, dude? Really? 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 Okay, so first of all, you've lost all credibility as a rational adult explaining things. When you say that in 2020, that this is the worst shape the world's ever been in. Are you freaking kidding me? Are you kidding me? And DC has forgotten this bit of comics history and chosen this moment to leave Diamond. Okay, so... Diamond stopped distributing. Diamond is a distributor. If that frickin' soda machine near the frickin' pool at your apartment complex stops distributing sodas, stops selling them, you are going to go to the 7-Eleven across the street. This is a true story. That's why I got so emotional talking about it. to leave out that major part of it while also talking like some sulky teen. Like, the world's like trash. And it's canceled. Okay, so right now, you have no credibility, and I'm just hoping there's some good cringe at the end. You've no doubt read their statement about how this move was intended to strengthen the marketplace. Pardon the profanity, but that's bullsh with the I as a dash, and then he didn't even... Uh-oh, someone's getting a little wild. We better take your ginger ale away. This is a hasty, sociopathic decision made by people who do not care about the long-term welfare of our marketplace, let alone about comics. Okay, here's the deal, fella. DC, along with a very, very, very limited amount of companies out there, have not done any layoffs or furloughs and been able to keep everyone in business or, as your boy did, actually add more books to the publishing schedule for this week. You can do that if you treat your company like a business and not like a table in a middle school lunchroom. It's called having more than 2 weeks of freaking cash reserves. DC stated multiple reasons for their change. One of which was, what was that phrase? Stagnant market growth over multiple years. It's the same reason Image Comics drastically reduced the amount of books they published last year because you couldn't sell your shit anymore. You went from that company that had all of the, you know, the major, you had the Spawn and the frickin' Cyberforce and Savage Dragon, and now you got some of that stuff. I mean, Spawn's actually selling okay now again, but it wasn't for a while. Savage Dragon sells nothing. You basically produce a bunch of Netflix pitches. That's what you do. And customers, you know, those people that your Image partners call Nazis, they got tired of buying your Netflix pitches, so they just didn't buy them. It's a real simple equation. And you weren't helping the marketplace either by flooding the shelves with Netflix pitches. So DC decided, among multiple factors, stagnant market growth, needing revenue, being trapped into these ridiculous Faustian deals of, oh, we can't sell digital for cheaper than print, so, but we need revenue or we're going to have to lay off people. But we, the entire industry revolves around not displeasing Brian Hibbs. What should we do? Oh yeah, fuck that guy. We're going to keep all of our employees by increasing revenue. So they started the DC Digital First, which was repurposed Walmart books. They stepped it up and they encouraged two mail order businesses essentially to become full distributors because the spice needs to flow. Remember when you were all kumbaya on freaking March 18th? Well, they need to pay their employees. They don't want to lay off their employees during a recession, and that's what it is now. It's funny to learn about the market because in some ways the market is very simple, and in some ways it's terrifying. You would not believe how much of the economy depends on feelings. When the market goes up and you read why, it says, people felt good. They read this and they felt good, and it jumps up. And then the next day it's like, oh, they read this in the news, and then they felt bad, and then it plummeted. And it plummeted today because basically people stopped being like super optimistic and they're like, oh, you know, the economic damage is, it's going to go on for a while. And that now we got freaking riots and all this stuff all over the place. So they're basically settling in for a long haul. Whereas, you know, a couple weeks ago, everything was rah-rah. And they're like, you know, we're going to reopen everything by July. And then Antifa was like, how do you reopen a burned down store? So Getting back to this article. The good news is, just that as Marvel wasn't capable of destroying our industry back in 1994, DC, still a distant second to Marvel after all these years, isn't going to either. So let's just go to... I went to Comic-Con. I went to February, since February was the last month where there was really, you know, full distribution. Marvel had 47%, mostly because they were flooding the shelves with unsellable, unreturnable crap, but... comic book store owners who were not thinking through just said, Marvel movies. So they ordered all this shit and they got stuck with it. DC is at 30%. DC was at 30% because they trimmed their line for the same reason you did, Image, because there were less customers because of years of stagnant market growth. DC, no layoffs, no furloughs. Marvel has basically furloughed almost their entire staff. And for people who don't know what furlough is, that's unemployment with health insurance. By the way, how did they pay their deductible? Some of you are concerned with Diamond's continued stability after losing DC's business. But the truth of the matter is that DC is around 30% of Diamond's comics business. And Diamond doesn't just deal in comics. In addition to distributing comics, Diamond also distributes toys, games, and other merchandise, with games in particular being an increasingly large part of their business. Okay, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so as far as comics are concerned, though, the rest of the marketplace accounts for 70% or so of Diamond's direct market business. This doesn't mean that it isn't going to be a challenge for Diamond and for the rest of the marketplace, but it's not quite the death blow so many seem to fear. Okay, so if it's not a death blow, then... why are you mad? What? Why is it hasty and sociopathic if they just chose their own path based on multiple factors? That fear, though, the fear that has prompted emails and texts from so many of you, and which has been coursing through the retail community since the news dropped last Friday, underscores something that should alarm everyone in comics. Excuse me, I have a question, because I'm actually reading your letter. You basically said everything was fine. Diamond distributes lots of things besides comics. They lost 30% of the comic marketplace, but that's not their entire business. So what's the problem? DC did this without any consideration for how it would affect the rest of the marketplace. I'm sorry. I keep reading your letter where you said it was fine. Do you remember? Oh my gosh, he's quoting Maya Angelou. There's a great Maya Angelou quote that, along with the quote I opened with, is one of my all-time favorites. When someone shows you who they are, believe them the first time. Generally speaking, when a publisher leaves one distributor for another, there is a transition period. Inventory and data are transferred. Accounts are taken care of. Everything is done with careful planning so that all involved parties can move forward with peace of mind. When Marvel bought Heroes World and pulled their business from their other distributors, they gave notice, not in terms of days, but months. That is not what happened here. I got another question. When Marvel flooded the shelves for years, you didn't say jack shit. DC gave their notice. What do they have to do? They don't have to join your suicide pack. Todd McFarlane said the same thing. He's like, I'll play along for a couple weeks, but I'm not joining the suicide pack. You have no cash reserves. You decided to transition to being basically a mailboxes, etc., that sends Netflix pitches to Hollywood. So DC's got a layoff? You're all power to the people, man. Why don't you care about the DC employees and not want them furloughed like everyone else, pretty much everyone else, furloughed their employees? With everything going on right now, not just a global pandemic that has left our economy on the brink of depression. Okay, dude, you're my age. You're on the executive board. You're the publisher. We are just entering a recession. It's one quarter of negative growth. We're not remotely closer to a depression. Like, come on. What do you think this teenager hyperbole and tantrum is going to do? Aren't you, as the leader, supposed to reassure people? You're telling people don't worry, And then you're using this apocalyptic, you know, freaking phraseology. On the brink of depression, but an unprecedented number of nationwide protests against police brutality and institutional racism, DC decided to blindside Diamond and the rest of the industry with their decision to end a decades-long business relationship. Oh, excuse me, I have a question. How much notice did Diamond give before they stopped distributing comics? Oh, shit! They're the second largest publisher of comics and graphic novels in the United States, owned by one of the largest telecommunications companies in the world, and financially more secure than almost any publisher in comics, as Clownfish TV, Nerdrotic, I believe that Umbrella guy have made dozens of videos mentioning Warner, whatever that conglomerate is called. They're like stupidly in debt. Like hundreds of million dollars, or I believe maybe even like $1 billion in debt. Like they're ridiculously in debt. And one of the ways they get out of debt is they start cutting corners. They start increasing profit. They do not get that way by agreeing to a ridiculous hippy-dippy suicide pact to have no revenue for 3, 6, 9 months. What the hell is that? They didn't have the resources to give even a few months' notice? You're in an industry that didn't have 2 weeks of cash reserves. DC was supposed to like not have revenue or lose money for months just to be the nice guy when that was not done to them? This is insane. Not just out of professional courtesy, but out of consideration for the rest of the retail and consumer marketplace. They will continue to operate in regardless of who distributes their books, their comics. So as we have seen from Lunar at least, massively superior service to that of Diamond. It's amazing how much competition will spur improved service. And there was, you know, there was some complaints about, you know, the price being too high. There's another article on Bleeding Cool today about how they have more affordable solutions. They're now serving overseas and everything's getting better very, very quickly. It's amazing what the lack of a so-called benign monopoly will do for improvements in service. Ultimately, what this all boils down to is distributor confusion causing retailer panic and disarray. Okay, excuse me, I have another question. How much retailer panic was by you saying this is the worst the world has ever been and we're going into a depression? Because both of those are fundamentally untrue. But you're a publisher and you're telling retailers that. How are they going to adjust their orders being told they're going into a depression? Which again, is not remotely true. We are, you know, looking at probably at least a couple quarters of a recession. But the good news is the things that usually lead to, you know, tens or a decade of recession, that didn't really happen. You know, we didn't have a major terrorist attack. We didn't have, all the crops in the Midwest die. We don't have a world war. We don't have those things. And at the end of the supply chain, you have Batman readers wondering, what in hell is going on? Actually, the only thing they're wondering is what is happening in the James Tynion IV Batman issue that actually got to stores because DC decided to get multiple distributors. They're getting their books. They're getting their books. The Batman readers are getting their books for the same price they were before and probably in better condition. So what the hell are you complaining about there, fella? And embarrassingly, it's nothing more contrived than negligent behavior and a deep lack of business acumen and poor internal leadership. And you're telling people, panic, 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 and you're like, look at this lack of leadership. No, all the lack of leadership is right squarely in you. This might be forgivable for a smaller company with fewer resources and less history in the market, but not from a publisher of DC's stature. So this is a little hint. Whenever they attack someone, it's literally because they've determined that that person or group is not any threat at all. You see that with something like Babs Tarr. Her own peers and so-called friends attack her and try to cancel her. Various people who align with CG or, you know, they're just regular people who don't like to see others canceled. And then what she does, fuck you, Comicsgate fucks. The reason she says that is because she knows there's no danger from Comicsgate people. She's completely fine and safe with him. The danger is from her peers. The danger to the market was from Marvel flooding the shelves with unsellable, unreturnable crap produced by absolute frauds, hiring people based on their skin tone, skin color, religion, or their gender identity, or their sexuality. Predictably, a very low percentage of those people are actually good. Eve Ewing is the exception. She's actually fairly solid. They hired her not because she's a solid writer. They hired her because of her skin color and hair and gender. But he will not call out Marvel because Marvel will freaking destroy them. DC's just trying not to lay off their own employees. But anytime you see somebody in the mainstream in the status quo bucking up, it's always because they know they are safe from the person they're bucking up on. They will never buck up on someone who will actually harm them. But they'll try to, you know, assuage their ego and look tough by, you know, oh, you Comicsgate fucks, fuck you. To put that in perspective, there are Image creators who have requested that we hold off on promoting their work because they think it would be tone deaf against the backdrop of current events. But DC made this move as though they were not only tone deaf, but completely oblivious to anything other than their own ambitions. No, I think they were trying to keep their own employees from being laid off, like all of your woke buddies did without a second thought. By the way, y'all check on any of your employees you furloughed? How are they paying the rent? How are they eating? How are they paying the deductible? Anything? Are they alive? Are they dead? Do you know? Our industry is more than one publisher, though, and we will get through this. Should something happen to Diamond, we aren't without our options, both within the direct market and the book trade. But as of now, the hope is that exploring those options won't be necessary. Should that change at any point, we will let everyone know. Well, hopefully Steve Jeppy and Diamond give you 3-4 months notice like you are saying is the standard and not a couple days like they did last time. I have spoken with Steve Jeppy and members of the Diamond team about what's happening, as has Image's president, Todd McFarlane. Our takeaway is that while there will definitely be some challenges ahead for the marketplace...
Do you mean the oncoming worldwide depression?
You know, people can remember things in the same letter, you know what I mean? Like, we don't all have, like, brain damage. Like, I remember the stuff you wrote 5 paragraphs above.
Diamond is not on the verge of collapse. Someone asked me if Image is still being paid by Diamond, and we are.
It's about to get real sad.
Back when Diamond stopped shipping due to COVID-19 and the various statewide stay-at-home orders?
It's weird because I've talked to people who, there are states where there's basically nothing's changed. They were just like, hey, don't cough in people's mouths. We don't know why we have to say that. You should have never been coughing into each other's mouths, but don't do that. Nothing got shut down, no mask orders, and there was no giant, you know, spike in, you know, cases. It wasn't due to COVID, although that was a major factor. It was due to that they were basically, August Walker says in Mission Impossible Fallout, hope is not a strategy. They were operating off of hope and the idea that constant revenue would flow, and they could always just kind of front things forever. And then when that slowed down, everything collapsed very quickly. 2 weeks. The old comic book industry that is never coming back in the way it was died in 2 weeks. Pathetically so. Frustrating though it was, prompted Diamond to set up reduced payments to publishers. I remember Steve Jeppy bragging that he had a massive line of credit with J.P. Morgan? Is that J.P. Morgan Chase, whatever it's called? I was like, weird flex, but okay. Like, you can't pay people, but you got a giant line of credit. Okay. Whatever. The way those payments were structured meant that for 8 weeks, we received 25% of what we were owed for sales, made from late January to mid-March.
Wait. You didn't get paid in full for the stuff that happened before COVID, before the shutdown,
prompted Diamond to set up reduced payments to publishers. With the remaining 75% to be paid out over the following 8 weeks.
So you still are not even remotely close to being paid back for the stuff that you're owed from pre-COVID.
While that wasn't ideal at the time, this is like requesting a wedgie. While that wasn't ideal at the time, the payments we are now receiving are making up for the period when stores were not receiving new product, and we are well on our way back to something approaching, quote, normal. We're almost a month into shipping comics again, and while not all stores have reopened yet, the drops in our book orders have been relatively minor. Well, I wonder how much they're going to drop in that oncoming worldwide depression you told people is coming. Some titles' orders have actually increased from what they were at pre-COVID. In other words, there are reasons to be hopeful. That's not easy for everyone, and that's understandable. Image isn't owned by AT&T or Disney. Image doesn't have an overall first look deal with Paramount or Netflix or Amazon Studios or Legendary or Hivemind or any of the other IP farms with little actual interest in selling comics. Who cares? Okay, first of all, if that's not a big deal, then why are you mentioning it? If it is a big deal, why don't you have it? Image did not start 2 or 3 years ago. You started in what, like 1992? Why don't you have these connections? 90% of your output is very obvious Netflix pitches. We're not like everybody else. When Image first started, there were many who accused the Image founders of leaving Marvel and setting up... Excuse me, did they give them multiple months' notice? Is that what I've heard is the standard? When you make a change in your business, you have to give them multiple months of notice, right? No, they just basically made demands and just walked out. Yeah, okay, yeah, shut the fuck up. Many accused the Image founders of leaving Marvel and setting up their own company out of self-interest. And given how incredibly successful Image was in the beginning, you know, not anymore, they could have easily just produced their own comics and left it at that. What they did instead, though, was invite their fellow creators to join in building the company they'd started. Or as Image's former executive director Larry Martyr once put it, to cast off their work-for-hire shackles and join the revolution. As a result, Image doesn't operate like other publishers, least of all Marvel and DC. Tell me more about this Marvel. You seem to not have much of an opinion on it. That makes publishing with Image a little daunting at times because not like Marvel and DC can sometimes be construed as, I have to do everything myself and I don't get a page rate. And what if nobody buys my book and I never make any money doing this? And will I ever be able to get a job anywhere else again if this doesn't work out? But Image has been the company it is for going on 30 years now because it offers creators the same independence. Rob, Todd, Jim, Mark, Eric, Wilson, Valentino. Name is Jim. I don't know why you did first names for everyone and last names for... Crave for themselves back in 1992. It isn't always easy, and that independence is at times fraught with hardship and uncertainty, but that independence is what makes it possible for everyone, from a relative unknown at the beginning of their career to a bona fide superstar, to work with Image instead of for Image and share the same opportunities. Or at least the opportunities they want to share. So getting back to DC, and where the comics industry has suddenly wound up as a result of their decision to dissolve their distribution agreement with Diamond, this isn't the first time one of our industry's big two has shown us who they are. And as history has proven repeatedly, it's not the last. That's scary and stressful for all of us, but at the same time, moments like these are why Image exists. We believe in comics, we believe in this industry, and we believe in you. And despite how bleak things may look now as we shelter in place, I'm not shelter in place, and worry what surprises tomorrow might bring, we believe there are better days ahead. Sincerely, E.S. Sad, pathetic, and either lying or just woefully uninformed about the world. We are absolutely not heading into a depression. We have started a recession. It is a mild one so far. Indicators are still for recovery. Just looks like it's being pushed back. You can thank your local Antifa for burning down entire downtowns and parts of cities and terrorizing people. Because things were, you know, on the mend. There was an incredible recovery. A lot of people's portfolios had completely recovered from the depths of mid-March already, and we're growing. There's no reason to stick with someone. How is DC breaking a contract, but Diamond isn't? they changed the terms of payment, they stopped distributing, and then when they did distribute again, they had a stupid sticker and damaged books. And I think on the third week, they actually put some bubble wrap in there, but Lunar did it from their first week. This is called competition. This is called business. Not your stupid-ass little club of people who pretend to like each other, but turn on each other at the drop of a hat. DC stepped up. A couple other, you know, small indies stepped up, and you're just whining. I mean, it doesn't look like you have any business acumen. It looks like when good times are good, you just assume that's because of your amazing leadership. And when bad times come in, you just start pointing the finger. DC took care of their employees. They're doing their job as a company. They could have laid people off. They made specific decisions to not lay people off. If you're so powerful to the people, you should be applauding them for that. You should try to step up in the way that they stepped up. You should try to be agile. Turn on a dime. Let's just do this pablum about 30 years ago when your own founders did what you're castigating DC for, making a sudden decision because, hey, we got to do this. This is in our best interest. And it was in their employees' best interest. And I don't know who you're serving besides your own ego and your fear of your vicious peers who you call friends. So anyway, thanks for watching. Subscribe. Make sure you're still subscribed. Hit the bell for notifications. Thanks to everyone giving to the GoFundMe, the Patreon, and the Indiegogo. Jawbreakers Grand Bazaar. I'm going to be working on the variant cover with Kyle Ritter. Expendables Go to Hell. Being lettered right now. Pandemic. Got it. Working on the script tonight. Anyway, thanks for watching.